This world is not my home. I'm just a passer through. My treasures are made of love somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home.
Sunshine, and boy, does it start to feel a little bit more and more like summer each and every day. So we'll take it. It was kind of a busy week again. We had our steak fry over at New Hope this week. Oh Lord, what was that, Thursday? But on Thursday afternoon, it was a blessing to see all the support we had from the community come out and show up for that. So that was something to look forward to. Charlie Grove steaks, they're unmatched, so really good. Good fellowship as well. Announcement, we did move back our community breakfast, so that's going to be the first week of July. So, what was that, July 6th?
Second.
Yes, so it was on the 2nd, yep. Amen. We kind of transitioned right into announcements here, but I suppose we'll do that. So the 2nd, we're going to have our breakfast here in that morning. Tara's going to have a date night on the 26th of June at the Retreat Sportsman Club. The last one we had was incredibly fun. There was some good food and fellowship and games and a little bit of uplifting message there as well. So that was something to come and join, so you can do that. It's 26th as well. And then also on the 3rd of July, it's a Sunday night, we're going to host kind of like a party at the parsonage almost. We'll have a campfire going up. Something I've always done at the churches that I've served is bought a ton of fireworks. I love blowing stuff up. So we're going to have a cookout. We'll have hot dogs and food, and it should be a lot of fun. Maybe some guitar over there, who knows. So more than welcome to swing on by. So anything else that I'm missing for announcements coming up in the near future? I know this particular week we've got a couple of things, or two Bible studies. Three. Is there three this week? There's not three this week. There's two this week. Now, this is what happens. You send Jeff the PowerPoint pretty late and he can't fix it. So, good Lord. Anyways. On Thursday, we have a food pantry. So, if there's nothing else, let's get our hearts and our minds ready for worship with the preparation of our hearts. God, I give you my heart,
my mind, and my attention. Help me listen to your calling for me today. I'm walking in here ready to receive your spirit. I'm walking out of here changing for the better.
Amen. So if you guys would please stand for hymn number 89.
Oh,
seated. All right, if you're going to follow along in your bulletins or on the screens with the call to worship, please join for the bolder people's hearts. Open our ears
to hear your word.
Open our eyes
to see your presence.
Open our arms
to the grace of community.
Open our minds
to the beauty of truth.
Open our hearts
to the joy of new life.
Amen. Let us pray together the opening prayer. Mighty God,
everything you do reveals your glory and your majesty. Open our eyes to see what you are doing in our lives. Let us marvel at your good gifts and your wise provisions. As we gather today around your name, we pray that you would fill our hearts, our minds, and our souls. Transform us, Lord, and make us more like you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. All right, so we are picking right back up where we left off in the book of Nehemiah here today. This is 9 verses long. Pete's going to come on up and read scripture today. So hopefully you guys have been taking bits and pieces away from the entire book of Nehemiah. It's really, really cool when we break it down how much it speaks to us today. So here you go, Pete. Okay.
Our scripture again comes from Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 1 through 9. When Sanballat heard that we were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and was greatly incensed. He ridiculed the Jews, and in the presence of his associates and the army of Samaria, he said, "What are these feeble Jews doing? Will they restore the wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Will they finish it in a day? Can they bring the stones back to life from the heaps of rubble, burned as they are?" Tobiah the Amorite, who was at his side, said, "What they are building, even a fox climbing up on it would break down their wall of stones. Hear us, O God, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over as plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight, for they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. So we build the wall till all of it reached half its height, for the people worked with all their heart. But when Sanballat, Tobiah, the Arabs, the Amorites, and the people of Ashdod heard the repairs to the Jerusalem wall had gone ahead and that the gaps were beginning to close, they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. But we prayed to our God and posted a guard day and night to meet this threat."
Amen. Thank you, Pete. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Will you please stand for the glory of Patrick? This is one of the Sundays in the United Methodist Church, at least in Wisconsin anyways, where it is mostly lay supply Sunday, as most of the clergy are up at annual conference right now. It's in Green Bay this particular year. It's been in Green Bay the last couple of years. I liked it a lot more when it was in Madison, although we are a little bit closer to Madison than Green Bay, and a little bit biased there. So they're all up there, and they're voting on that stuff for United Methodist Church, and they're talking about stuff happening in our churches, and then they have worship on Sunday mornings, but that's where most of the clergy are this morning over in Green Bay. I've never, ever been a fan of annual conference. In fact, I've only stayed for the duration of the entire thing one time, and the reason I'm putting this later in the service, in case we have any people who watch early and be like, okay, he's bashing on all these annual conferences and stuff. But I'd much rather be over here and keep doing the stuff we're doing and stay in ministry over here. Anyways, in terms of annual conference today, if you want to follow along, you can go online and you can catch back up if you haven't been following along with United Methodist Church in Wisconsin. There's nothing crazy that's getting passed along this particular year. Next particular year, there'll be some more interesting stuff coming up that you might want to look at. But if you want to go and follow along, you can go to United Methodist Conference page, and you can follow along there. They have a worship service this morning led by the bishop. So, anyways, I figured I'd throw that out there. It is the annual conference for the United Methodist Church. Well, if it's all right, if you guys like to open up with a little bit of humor, and sometimes it's not that funny, but we'll give it a shot. I told this one at the nursing home on Friday. There was this farmer who was getting ready to go to bed, and he's looking out his window, and he sees the barn back there, and the lights are on. Well, he didn't leave the lights on, so he's wondering what's going on out there. Well, the doors are open, and he looks carefully. He sees these burglars taking out some of his farm equipment. They're loading it in their truck. So he runs over to the phone, and he calls 911. He says, "Operator, I need some help here. I've got burglars at the farm." The operator says, "I'm sorry, sir. We don't have any patrol cars available right now. You're just going to have to go to your door and lock it and stay safe. Stay put. We'll get to you as soon as we can." He hangs up the phone, and 30 seconds later, he calls 911 again, and he says, "Hey, no need to send any patrol cars over here. I shot them all." He hangs up the phone. Well, 90 seconds later, you won't believe it, four patrol cars pile in the driveway. He's got an ambulance coming by, the sheriff, the deputy, they're all there, and they catch all the burglars red-handed. The sheriff comes up to the farmer and says, "I thought you said you shot them. We got all of them uninjured. They weren't shot at all." He says, "Yeah, and I thought you said you didn't have any patrol cars." Good Lord. Anyways. Alrighty. Let us go to the throne of grace in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, what an absolute blessing it is to be in your word today. Lord, help us learn and picture Nehemiah as he's going through this experience. Lord, put us right where he's at, in his shoes. But Lord, also, as we leave this place, remind us that we are called and equipped to handle what you have placed in front of us. Help us take something in application from your word today. In your name we pray. Amen. 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 So, that's something I love about the Bible, and it's actually one of the reasons that I preach in the style that I do, verse by verse, and I really don't tell that many stories all the time because my stories suck. They're not very good. But the scripture has power on its own if we go verse by verse and break it down. I don't need to do too much for it. God can speak through it, so... if that's all right, we're just going to pick up with a little bit of context here. You might be wondering if you've got your Bibles, where did chapter 3 go? Where did chapter 3? We didn't do chapter 3 at all, and there's a reason for it. Chapter 1, we know Nehemiah. Nehemiah's a cupbearer to the king, and he's serving one day, and he gets this bad news from some of his friends. They say Jerusalem's not in a good spot right now. The walls are down, they're living in disgrace. They're vulnerable to attacks, they're weak right now, and the enemy forces around them are strong. They need help. So we know that's in chapter 1. What does Nehemiah do when he hears this news? We notice he goes to prayer. And that's a theme that we should keep in the front of our minds the entire book of Nehemiah, is that before he says anything, does anything, he goes to prayer. God, give me the wisdom, give me the guidance, let my actions, let my words be yours. Prayer should be our first option, not our last resort. And when we do that, we're step for step with what the Lord is trying to have us do, where he's trying to bring us. Sometimes he gives us the clarity that we need when we go to prayer first. You know, I'm guilty of doing that myself sometimes. Sometimes I'll slip up, make a mistake, get myself in a situation that I should not be in. And then when I can't do it on my own, then I go to prayer. Nehemiah shows us that a man or woman of faith goes to prayer right away. Anyways, I love that. He prays for 4 straight months. God, be with Jerusalem, be with your city, be with the hurting, comfort them, give them peace, strengthen them, revive them for 4 straight months. And then we know what happens. One day the king says, "Hey, Nehemiah, you don't look okay. What's wrong?" This was God. God was opening an opportunity. He was opening a door. And Nehemiah was prepared, and he said, "Jerusalem needs your help." So the king, keep in mind, this is going to come up today. The king says, "Not only will I help you, I will give you the resources that you need, the lumber, the gates, the manpower. I'll send people with you. But keep this in mind. He says, I will also give you royal papers to take with you. A right of safe passage as you're traveling 800 miles to get to that city. He gives him those papers. Those papers are going to pop up today. So he shows these papers as he's walking through cities. They say, hey, what are you doing here? What are your intentions? He says, I'm permission from the king. I've got royal decrees here, instructions that the king has granted me safe passage. So they let him on through. He gets to Jerusalem. That's what we talked about 2 weeks ago. And the first thing he does, when you think that he'd have bright eyes and he'd go to work and pick up a shovel and build the walls right away, he's been dreaming about this moment. He's been visioning it in his head. He's ready to step into this new chapter. And sometimes just when we're about to step into this season of promise, this season of blessing that we've been praying and hoping for, we go right to work. Nehemiah again shows us he goes to prayer. He goes to prayer. 3 straight days, he doesn't do a thing. 3 straight days, he's waiting for God to guide him. God, you got me all the way here. I know it wasn't my own steps, my own work, but Lord, it was your will. And Lord, it's still going to be your will as I go into this season that I've been praying for. That's a good reminder for us too. Keep putting the Lord first. So we know he inspects the walls, and then he stands up and says, we need to rebuild this wall. And the people say, yes, let's rebuild this wall. And it's more cool than that. These are people living in defeat. They accepted the things the way they are. Nothing can get better. They have hope again. They're starting to think bigger again. Like maybe we have a purpose still. Maybe we can still do something. And guys, there's a lot of times, especially in a worldwide church, where we start thinking the church might be in a spot like that. Maybe we can rebuild again. Maybe we can still be potent in our ministries today. Even though society says the church doesn't do much, your God can't do much for you, it doesn't do much for me, maybe the church can have hope again, that we can still be influential and potent. We can still make disciples of Jesus Christ. We can still help the poor and the needy and the sick and be what Christ has called us to be. You know, maybe we're not too far different. Well, then we get to chapter 3, and we skip chapter 3, because these are a lot of funny names. If you want to go home and read it, you can. This is Nehemiah giving each person a task. You have a task to build this section of the wall. You build the gate. You get the southeast section. You use these materials. And there are a lot of funny names, and sometimes we can get caught up in that. But you can go and look in chapter 3. I hope you do pick up that Bible this week and pick up. And here we get to see in chapter 4, 1 through 9, that this wall is being put up pretty quickly, actually. And we get to see the people working in unity. And this wall that was never supposed to come back, that was never supposed to be revived, we get to see that maybe God has a plan for them. So here in the first verse, it says, when Sanballat heard that they were rebuilding the wall, he became angry and greatly incensed. So now he's seeing the progress. He's seeing the walls go up. Those stones that were just rubble are now being cleared away, pushed out of the way, and replaced with good ones. And Sanballat, we got to remember, he is not the good guy in this story. In fact, he's an opposition of Nehemiah and Jerusalem. He had one of the kingdoms right outside, and if Jerusalem had its walls back up, then they could be a pain in his side. And in fact, we get to see that him and Tobias, if you have your Bibles and you flip back a little bit beforehand, it says here in chapter 2, verse 10, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite heard about this, they were very much disturbed. When they heard that someone wanted to build the wall up, he was disturbed. But then we get to see in 19, when they said, let's start rebuilding, and they started rebuilding, we get to see, but when Sanballat the Horonite and Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed. So we went from disturbed to mocking and ridiculing, and here today we get to see that when he sees the progress being done, and he sees that it's actually happening, it says he is greatly angry. And here it says, greatly incensed. So this is what we get to see. Today we're going to learn a little bit about the forces that do seem to work against us sometimes and how we today can still battle them, because we are equipped. And just like Nehemiah faced opposition, there's a lot of opposition that you might be thinking, well, I'm going through some of that today too. So we get to see one of the things that he is facing here. It says he ridiculed the Jews in the presence of his associates in the army of Samaria. So he starts tossing insults at them. He starts belittling them. And what his goal is to do is to make it seem like the task that they're taking part right now, the wall that's going up, is way too big for something that they can accomplish. It's never been done before, and these aren't the people that are equipped to do it. They're not big enough or strong enough. They don't have the resources that it takes. One of the forces that he's trying to use right now, one of the things he's trying to use is discouragement. Discouragement. And discouragement is something that we face a lot today. I heard about this story. It's a story about the devil here, and the devil said he's put all his tools up for sale. He's got envy and lust and greed, and he's got all this stuff for sale. And a guy's walking around the shop and says, well, why is that one priced so high? He says, oh, that's discouragement. I priced that high because that's one of the tools I use the most. That's the one that happens most of the time. In fact, it works pretty good. That's why I have it priced the most. With it, I can pry open a man's heart. I can pry open their mind. I can get inside, and that's when the other tools go to work, after they feel discouraged. If you start to think about that, discouragement is something that we face a lot. Someone might hurl something at you to make you feel weak, to make you feel like you're unequipped, that you don't have what it takes. Discouragement happens a lot in today's society. We get to see examples of this discouragement here. It says, what are those feeble Jews doing? What are those weak Jews doing? What are the ones that can't do this task here? Will they restore this wall? How can they fix this wall? Will they offer sacrifices? Oh, are those small people going to pray to their gods? Is that going to get the wall built? It says, will they finish in a day? Oh my goodness, are they going to finish in a day? Can they bring these stones back to life from those heaps of rubble? Because that's all they have to work with. There's heaps of rubble, as burned as they are. Discouragement. You know, something about discouragement, we get to see here, it shows up about halfway through the task. Discouragement is something that really pops up in our life when we're about halfway through something. We start evaluating where we're at, and we're evaluating where we want to be, and it's a spot in the process where our achievements don't really match the energy that we put into it. It doesn't see the progress that we put into it. You know, we're doing all this hard work, but we're not seeing the good results. We study for a test, but sometimes we don't see a positive grade. We go to work and we do give our absolute best. We put all our energy and our effort into our task, but we don't see promotion. We don't see increase, you know? Discouragement. We can easily become discouraged here. And these people who have been working for such a long time now, they've been building and putting their energy into this wall, they're starting to feel fatigued. They're about halfway up, and they see all these enemies around them, and they see the opposition, and they start to hear these words, you can't do that. You're not big enough. You're not strong enough. Well, here I got to, well, I got my, the printer wasn't working, so hopefully I can do this here. Hebrews chapter 10, 38 says, but my righteous will live by faith, and my whole being won't be pleased with anyone who shrinks back. We aren't the sort of people who timidly draw back and end up being destroyed. We're the sort of people who have faith so that our whole beings are preserved. Hear these words. This is Joshua, and I, have I not commanded you, be strong and courageous. Do not be frightened. Do not be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you forever, wherever you go. This is how Nehemiah combats all these negative insults being thrown at him, all the things that are coming his way that can easily get inside his head, that can easily change his actions and make him slow down in progress or even stop the job completely. We get to see here it says, hear us our God in verse 4, for we are despised. Turn their insults back on their own heads. Give them over plunder in a land of captivity. Do not cover up their guilt or blot out their sins from your sight. For they have thrown insults in the face of the builders. You know what Nehemiah is doing here? Going to prayer. Again and again and again. Before he lets it even seep into his brain, he says, God, what they're saying right now is not against me, Lord. This is your wall, your will. Lord, I'm here because of you. They're insulting you. He's letting it bounce and deflect off of him and going straight to the Lord. So, Lord, you take this, you take their words and turn it back around on him. If you go back in the book of Jeremiah, that's almost exactly Jeremiah's prayer. Jeremiah 18:23 says, but you, Lord, you know all their plots to kill me. Do not forgive their crimes or blot out their sins from your sight. Let them be overthrown before you. Deal with them in your anger. You know what he's also saying? Lord, you've given me this job. I've got a lot left to do. I don't have time for their insults. They're not going to slow me down. So while I'm doing your will, you settle it. You take the reins. He prayed for God to handle the situation. And we get to see what our God does here when we bring it up to prayer. He's saying, God, you take care of them. You know what God does instead? He takes care of Nehemiah. He takes care of their people. He guards their hearts. He guards their mind. Their work never slows down, but instead we get to see they work for the Lord. Here in verse 6 it says, so they rebuilt the wall. Don't overlook that. That's an answered prayer right there. That's an absolute blessing. Well, they're trying to distract them, to take them off the course. They rebuilt the wall. God gives them a heart for work. He gives them a mind to see progress, to keep building, to keep pushing forward, till all of it reached half of its height. Then the people worked with all their heart. He prayed for God to work through them. You know what God did? He worked through them. He worked through Nehemiah. He worked through his people. Now we get to see one step further here. And I will stop rambling. I am talking a little bit today. When Sambai and Tobiah, we think they're done. We think that's all they have, just discouragement. I got a little bit more than discouragement here. We get to see him kick up the heat a little bit. It says the other people of Ashdod heard about the repairs to Jerusalem walls. Now they're starting to be afraid. The enemies are starting to worry a little bit that this is actually happening here. It says they were very angry. They all plotted together to come and fight against Jerusalem and stir up trouble against it. So they've gone from being disturbed to mocking and ridiculing them to discouraging them to now they're using fear. It's another opposition we face today. People will threaten you. People will try and scare you into doing what God has called you to do, from being where he's called you to be. We get to see fear being used. They're coming together. All these officials are talking together. This is Jerusalem. They're coming back. We can't have this. We need to do something. So they hurled threats. You guys better put down those shovels. Otherwise, we're going to attack you. You guys aren't going to like what happens next. But remember, we told you this would come back up today. The king gave him those royal papers. Those royal papers said, you cannot attack Jerusalem. You cannot come in here, because otherwise you're going against what the king has told you to do. And if you go against what the king has told you to do, you're going to face consequences from that. Those papers that the king gave Nehemiah are coming back to save him. So all they could do here is talk. All they could do here is use words. That was their biggest weapon at this point. Words of discouragement, words to cause fear, because they could not take action. And take note of that today, is that a lot of the things that get tossed at us, that we allow to break us down and make us feel defeated, are just words. They never actually get to the second part. They never see action. Don't let words bring you down. Don't let words make you think less of yourself. Don't let people put limitations on you. What Nehemiah does here, every time they put words on him, he says, okay, that's what you might think about me, but I know what the Lord says about me. I know what he calls me to be, and I know where he's calling me to be, and I'm not going to let your words stop his purpose. So we get to see here in verse 9, but we prayed to our God and posted a guard there day and night. I'm not even going to worry about attacks. We've got guards here watching. We're going to keep doing what God called us to do here. We're stopping at verse 9 here. I hope you pick up your Bible sometime this week. Read the rest of this chapter. It says that they build with one hand even, because they have a weapon in one hand, a sword in one hand, and a shovel in the other hand, because they're not going to slow down for other people's. Hopefully, this is a verse I hope we can take with us today. In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. That's Psalm 120. Verse 1, and this is the one that I love here, Romans chapter 8, 26. It's one I use a lot. It says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our time of weakness, for we do not know what to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. When we don't know what to ask for, we're in moments of weakness, the world seems like they're coming against us, we don't know what to do, what to say, the Spirit himself intercedes for us. He replaces that anxiety. He gives us peace, but he also gives us strength. And we know that we are equipped through the Lord to keep pushing forward. If you're facing discouragement now, if it feels like someone's trying to scare you or trying to make you feel like you can't do something, maybe we act like Nehemiah. We go straight to prayer. Let God's vision come. Let him give you transparency. But also, as you lead that prayer, know that God's walking with you every step of the way. He intercedes for us. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, it is a blessing to know that you use characters in the Bible to give us an example of faith. Lord, these brave men and women, these brave figures, even though it happened so long ago, Lord, it's so applicable for us today. Lord, as we are facing opposition, as people try to discourage us, Lord, give us strength. Keep our eyes fixed on you, for we know that faith is bigger than discouragement. Lord, help us to keep walking in confidence, knowing that you're right there with us. Your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. A little bit of talking, but that's actually kind of cool. I kind of like the way that the service is structured now, because I can watch the clock and we can still finish on time. That's okay. Oh, good Lord. All right, we have Come Now Fount of Every Blessing.
Yeah.
Amen. You may be seated. Now's the time to service for joys and concerns. Is there anything we need to lift up the power of prayer today? Yes.
I will say joys. Romans 8, chapter 28, just through the struggles that I've been through, God promises to move everything for those that love Him for good, not half the things, not 50% of the things, everything for good. I prayed and asked Him how I can praise Him through my lowest point in my life. He answered my prayer and opened doors that were amazing. I am now taking voice and piano lessons. Not just at the age of 50, I've never played music, but I am taking voice and piano lessons from the head instructor, Polly Papadopoulos, at Viterbo College. And someday my goal is to play the piano here and stay here. So that is my joy and how it's open doors for you.
You do it once, Pete, you're locked in for life. That's all. It
seems that way with the readings, too.
Amen, amen. All right, yes.
Yesterday, Hallie, not through the school, but through something else, does like running. Oh, how do I say all this? Anyway, she got 2 golds yesterday and 2, because she does high jump, and 2 bronze medals. And this is not affiliated with the school, they just use the school to train. And hopefully, if it goes good and she keeps doing good, she has to go now to the next level, and they're hoping to get her to state. And it's not through the school, it's through the state somehow. I don't even know how it's really run.
Like a summer track program or something?
Well, she can jump 4 feet 8 inches. And she's 13.
Oh, man.
Yes, and she's doing really well.
I don't even want to know how much we could jump here. We put a lot of us here at that bar.
That's almost as tall as me.
Good gracious. Oh, my Lord. That's always one of my favorite practices we had at track, was watching everyone try and high jump. You find out if you're good or not real quick. Real quick.
This jumping is running up, then go over backwards.
Yeah.
That's the jumping that she's doing.
Oh, my Lord. Anything else? Yes.
Keep praying for Cheyenne.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And Crystal and her mother. And Crystal's mother, they both came down with COVID in the middle of the week.
You're spending a lot of time out on that couch then, huh, Bill?
I've been staying at my place now for during the weekend, so.
Yeah. Joy or concern?
Relaxing break from
working. Amen to that. Amen to that. And prayers for all those people who do work outside, our laborers who do concrete construction, you know, all those heavy lifting stuff out in the elements, too. Summer's not easy in that, so thank you for your hard work, too. Yeah.
Prayers for Kathy Gelf Sanborn, who passed away a week ago today.
Mm-hmm. Family of Kathy Sanborn. Alrighty, also, yes?
To our grandpa. He's having heart problems again and through surgery.
Do you know your grandpa's first name, Peyton?
Mark.
That's impressive. I didn't know my grandpa's. They have first names? That took me for a long, long time. I just called him Grandma and Gramps. Amen. Heart problems there. Continue prayers for Gracie Isbell. She is in the hospital right now. Some stomach problems there. She's getting discharged. Yes.
Yeah, she's supposed to be discharged today. Her labs keep going in the right direction.
Yes. So continue prayer. It's a blessing to see that they're able to handle it as fast as they were. It's a real, real big scare, but they got ahead of that. So continue prayers for Miss Gracie. And she got a smile that was just infectious. Good Lord. I don't want to take up too much of your time. I thought it was an absolute blessing last week to go out and have a community worship, and oh, good Lord, I'm getting hurt here. Ouch. Wrap it up, Carter. We had fun down in the DeSoto community. I thought there might be 10 people there when it was cold and it was going to rain all day. It was real gray, and about half hour before we went to worship, the sun came out. We had outdoor activities afterwards. We played kickball, and to watch some of those parents interact with some of their kids remind me a lot of my upbringing. I know, Dave Wallace, he was pitching one time. Stella kicks it, daughter. She kicks it right over to him. He picks that ball up, and he does not spare any strength get her out of there. Right in the shoulder. But it was fun, too. Madison was over. You know, it's just a lot of fun to watch the kids out there having a ton of fun. And at a pie-eating contest, too, I whooped them. And the water balloon competition. But it's just fun to be out in the community. So it was an absolute blessing. On a day that we thought might have 10 people, might need to be canceled in general, we had a big, big turnout. And we had a lot of kids out there. So it was a lot of fun. So let us go to the throne of grace. If there's anything else, anyone have something else? I'm cutting people off here. All right, we're moving. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, there's so many things going on in our lives right now, but before we can ask for prayers for Lord, for healing, Lord, for restoration, Lord, we just need to stop and say thanks. Thanks for getting us to this point in the week, Lord. Thanks for helping us overcome the obstacles, Lord. For getting us out of the trouble and out of the harm's way that we didn't even know where you're in. Lord, thank you. Lord, thanks for walking with us through this life. And Lord, we have so many things we're going to lift up. It's a joy that no matter how old we are, Lord, you can still teach a dog, an old dog, new tricks. And Lord, be with Pete as he discovers possibly a new talent here, playing some music on piano and singing some voice lessons. Help him have the joy in trying something new. Lord, it's a blessing that we are able to use our talents and abilities that you have gifted us with and work on them and refine that. And we pray for all our student-athletes, Lord, that they continue to craft their skills. But Lord, we give thanks for Hallie as she's seeing good results. And Lord, we pray for strength and encouragement, Lord, for Cheyenne. Lord, this girl has such a potent personality. Lord, she is so infectious with her smiles, with her laughter. And Lord, we hope that she brings some of that spark back as she's going through a hardship that's lasted way too long. Give her the strength that she needs, Lord, to see progress, to see recovery. Lord, be with Cheyenne. Lord, we pray for all those facing COVID right now, for Crystal, for her mom. Lord, we pray for all those people that are feeling weak right now. Lord, we know that you are bigger than this virus. Protect them, guide them, bring them to recovery. Lord, we pray for the mourning of the passing of Kathy Sanborn, for the family right now going through a time of grief. Lord, be with them. Give them the peace and comfort they need. Lord, we ask that you are with Mark, Grandpa Mark, as he is having some heart problems. Lord, we ask that you give him the right medical staffs in front of him, that they give him the right procedures, the right treatments, Lord, to get in front of this. Lord, we pray that this doesn't continue to happen. Be with Mark. And Lord, we ask that you're with Gracie right now as she is getting discharged this morning out of the hospital. Sometimes we get put in a hard spot that we didn't see coming. And Lord, that we pray that Gracie continues to see health and recovery. God, there are so many things that we have not said out loud that we keep in our hearts and our minds. And Lord, the joys that you continue to present with us each day, Lord, hear our prayers. We pray this in the same way that your son Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. Amen. All right, we've got, now this one, I've heard this one for the first time. This is one I'm not familiar with. I didn't give you a whole lot of time for it, so maybe. It's catchy, it's on 365, verses 1, 2, and 4. You might recognize the chorus.
Thank you.
Nehemiah was doing something nobody thought that he ever could, and while he was doing good things and seeing a lot of progress, he faced opposition. People tried to get in his mind, get in his heart by bringing words of discouragement, and while his natural reaction for us would have been to react and let our tongues run wild, to let us see a halt in our progress, to let it affect us, he said, no, I'm giving it to God. And you know what God gave him back? A heart for work, to keep pushing forward. When you face words of discouragement, go to God. Let him give you a heart for progress. In your name we pray. Amen. And the people said, amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right, God be with you.